oriented towards the anthroposophical way of looking at the human being. Now we can ask, what is anthroposophy? Anthroposophy means, it comes from the Greek word anthropos, means the human being. And sophi, sophia, means the spirit. The spirit of the human being, or the wisdom. The wisdom is the spirit of the human being. And anthroposophy combines in itself a kind of a way of life. It's a way of life. And these 12 senses, the subject of 12 senses, is also under the tutelage of anthroposophy. We usually hear of 5 senses, isn't it? That we are so acquainted with 5 senses. We say, well, what are the 5 senses? Which we all know, the material senses. Exactly. Yes? Exactly. Yes, please. Welcome.
Mind as the sixth.
Yes, you can say that. There are, yes. But it is very interesting that at the time of the birth, what happens is that when a child is born, at the same time, there is brain mapping. What means brain mapping? Brain mapping means that all the constellations, the 12 nakshatra, which has to do with the mission of the human being on this earth. There are many, many nakshatra, many zodiacs, many constellations, but the 12 belongs to the human being. And during the brain mapping of the child, the constellations which are there in the heavens, in the sky, where there are the kind of constellation with the planets, which planet is working, what constellation works, which planet, all this is imprinted in our brain cells. Every cell represents the universe, the cosmos. We have countless cells in our body, and all these cells, they represent a part of the universal power, the culture, the universal culture. And that is something very, very fascinating, because our origin is the universe. And when we have this brain mapping and all the constellations which are in the brain, they actually, since parampara, our old rishis, they knew about this. So that is how astrology is born. Because each individual brings an imprintment of the constellation that human being has. And each one is an individual. There are millions and millions and billions born and die and born and die since the time the earth has been created. But each one is an individual, even Siamese twins who are kind of connected physically, they are also individuals. It's very interesting that there is so much of difference because of the time of the birth. And this time has been given as the 4 words from our Vedic Shastra. In the Rig Veda, there is a sentence. And this sentence, most of you must be knowing, it is called Para Pashyanti Madhyama Vaikhari. Aapko malum hai? You know this. Para Pashyanti Madhyama Vaikhari. Now, in order to know about the 12 senses, we have to really go right into the origin of what are the senses. You see, it's very interesting that when we talk about brain mapping, we have all the planets, the whole solar system is in the human being. All the 9 navgraha is in us as organs. We have the sun that represents the heart and so on. So, I mean, that most of us know, isn't it? And we have also mantras on our solar system. Each planet represents a mantra. Each planet. Because each planet represents a virtue. And that virtue, which is represented by each planet, is somatized as an organ. So when the child is born, then the child is spiraled, you know, it's spiral. the embryo is spiraled. And the birth of the universe is also a spiral. So you can imagine that what kind of representation we as human beings take with us and what responsibility we take with us. That when we have the spiral, we have the whole universe. And what happens is that from the brain mapping, the head is the largest when the child is made by these powers. We'll come up to Parapashyanti Madhyama Vaikari. What somatizes into the child will come a little later, but I'll just give you an image, a picture image. That's why I don't have any kind of PowerPoint representation, because each one of us is a PowerPoint, each one of us. So try to make an effort and make this kind of a picture image in you, that when you experience this powerful Brahmanda, which is the universe, Brahmand, it's called the Brahmand, Brahma, creation. And then when in the mother's cosmic womb, each one of us who is born is also born out of the spiral, and the head, as the brain mapping, slowly brings about the virtue and condenses into the limbs, into the organs, into the rest of the body, into the cells. And so our origin is there, the human being. That is our origin. Now, later on we'll make a little journey out there, but I would like to once more elucidate or speak or maybe bring about the representation of this sentence. Para means trance, transcendence, beyond. It's completely shunya. You can say shunya, something that is absolute. We cannot imagine with our limited mind, unless somebody like Ramana Maharshi or really enlightened human beings or our prophets, they can imagine, but I don't know. Most of us, we are not able to experience the para. In any case, because it's so beyond, para goes right into the transcendence. Pashyanti, that which illuminates, comes from the beyond and illuminates. It illuminates, it speaks, illuminates. We can even call it the Purush principle, the principle of Purush, which is undivided. And then comes Madhyama, that is the Prakriti. Madhyama means that consolidates. Everything that illuminates now slowly comes together, like in a magnifying glass. If you take all the rays of the sun, it gets power, isn't it? It can burn any texture. That's Madhyama, consolidating. And then comes Vaikari, distribution. It distributes. So what we are is Vaikari. All what you see in the Prakriti, every individuality, every plant, everything in nature, animals, insects, what have you, is Vaikari, distributing. So now, let us make a little journey out there. You know, that light travels 186,000 miles a second. One says it's the fastest traveling entity in the universe. But what is faster than light?
Mind.
Very good, it's the mind. Mind is the fastest traveling. You can see the constellations in a nanosecond. You can see it, that's it. But to travel there with the light will take I don't know how many years. It might take eons to travel to Mesh and to Rishabh and to Kark and all this. It will take a long, long, long time. Aries, Taurus, all these constellations. But our mind can travel. So if you wish, you can close your eyes, or if you wish, you can imagine, but we'll go on a little journey. Imagine we are now only mind, and with the mind, we are traveling away from the stratosphere. And we are going along the planetary chains. The closest planet is moon, and everything is shining, illuminating. Everything is light, 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 and we are going onwards towards the moon. Then we come to the nearest planet, Mercury, the fastest moving planet, next to the moon. Then we have the Venus. We are still rising, we are rising, we are rising. And it's very interesting, we are made also. The Muladhara Chakra, which is closest to the earth, is the moon chakra. Then we have the Mercury, that we are advancing a little higher. Right up to the Sahasrara, we are going to advance. So we go from Mercury into Venus. That is the Manipur Chakra, isn't it? We have it. We have all these planets in us. And then we have the sun, the heart, Anahata, Anahata Chakra, which is the heart. And then we rise further to the outer planets, and that's the Mars. Mars, powerful being. But we all have these planets in us. We can't say men from Mars and women from Venus. We have these planets in us. So we can't segregate. Impossible to segregate. And then we have Jupiter, Agnya Chakra, coming here now slowly. The Jupiter is the mightiest star of all that shine, except the sun alone. And then we go into the Saturn. So these are the seven planets that gives us the mission to be on Earth. And the two are not Graha, because we say now Graha, isn't it? They are the moon nodes. But they are not planets. But they also give us a lot of mission in life, a lot of destiny work to do. So actually, Saturn with its ring, what is the ring? The ring means the guardian of the threshold, Sahasrara. Finito. Uranus, Neptune and Pluto they don't belong to our solar system. They came much later because we don't have organs of Uranus, Neptune, Pluto. We have no organs of that. Our organs are made out of only Saturn, until Saturn, from the Moon, rising, Mercury, Venus, Sun, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn. We have seven main organs for seven main missions in life, destiny mission. But we don't have the organs of Uranus, Neptune and Pluto, which was discovered in 1930 and later on and so on. Many people say, many scientists, that these are the wandering stars that were caught up into the solar system, but they don't give us any mission on Earth. In any case, views are differing, and so we are rising now all the way towards the Saturn, and Saturn, which is the Sahasrara. And that is an old planet, very old, towards Moon, which is very young. So you see also the way we are made with our chakra, Moon that is coming closest to the Earth in the human being, which is the Muladhara Chakra right down, is the Moon as the planet which is closest to Earth. See how we are made? And then comes all these planets. And then when we go beyond Trans-Saturn, then we are coming slowly, slowly, slowly into the realm of the constellation. And the constellations are the ones that gives us the elements on Earth, the four elements. And the fifth is the Mahapanchabhuta. Now you can imagine, I'm not a very great drawer. I also have a little tremble in my arm, so it doesn't matter. But try to imagine. All right. We have the Brahman. All right. So let us take this as our own circle around us. Each one of us have our own inner space. And here we have, let us say, the cross. So we can say that this is the summer solstice and the winter solstice, and this is the spring and the autumn equinox. We all know what equinox means, isn't it? Balances. From the balance, it goes further. Now, when we imagine that what happens, that when the sun enters a certain season, we call it a season, we now will not speak about the constellations anymore. Now we just go over the seasons, which is qualitative. The 12 senses are qualitative according to the seasons in which the sun is situated. So when we go into the qualitative realm, then we go into the realm of what happens around in nature. And I'm sure you will be able to find out, maybe not each time, because sometimes it's very ambiguous, these senses. Now I'll just tell you something. Very often people say, oh, do we have the sense of this or that or that? Well, of course, we have all the senses which are in us, but the 12 main senses contain in themselves hundreds of other senses also. But why are these senses as senses? You know, it's very interesting. Senses as senses has been brought about. I'm sure it is all written in the Vedas, but in science it has come about. That many, I don't know when that was, in what exactly what century, but it was in the 18th century. There was a doctor, an Italian doctor called Pacini, Dr. Pacini, P-A-C-I-N-N-I, C is an Italian G, Pacini. And he saw that when he stimulated a certain part of the brain, then these cells, they have a very, they're like little onions, you know, and they have to be brought into their awakening. They have to awaken. And when he stimulated some of the parts of the brain, then that patient would experience, let us say, the sense of self-confidence, ego, well, I would say the sense of responsibility. All of a sudden that patient starts to talk about how responsible he feels, or the sense of balance, you know. They could walk even a small a beam, this way. So this was the 12 senses that he could decipher. Because of the Pacini cells, that's why they are called the Pacini cells. Pacini cells means that all our nerve endings, they end into the brain cells, and these brain cells can be stimulated into 12 different senses. That's why it's called the... When they stimulated the sense of taste, they were able to taste something, I don't know, something bitter or astringent. They could see when it was stimulated. So all these visual sense and the sense of taste and the sense of touch and the sense of hearing and sight, everything was stimulated by the Pacini cells. So this was how it was depicted, that the 12 senses has to do with the Pacini cells, which is completely related to the physical body. It's not just metaphysical, it's physical body. But it is our responsibility to activate these cells in the best possible manner. Because to have it stimulated, it says nothing to us. It's only that moment of being stimulated, that's all. And then it's over and done with. Who cares about sense of responsibility after the sense is stimulated? Nothing happens. Later on, the patient is where he is or where she is. But the thing is that how is one able to now go through this? So imagine, how are these senses built? I mean, after all, we have this sentence which is really like a treasure chest. Parapashyanti madhyama vaikari. It's a jewel box. It's a jewel box. And it's such a rubric that everything is contained in this sentence. So now if you imagine that this sentence, which contains the whole universe, And when the person is going through now the path of destiny, then these 12 senses gives the person the possibility to relate with the environment. Because we should not forget that the consolidated human being is nature, and the spread out human being is, well, the spread out human being is nature, and consolidated nature is the human being. Can I say it again? The spread out human being is nature, and consolidated nature is human being. All right? So we have really, because of an ant, we are living. Really, it is really true. Because every creature is a part and parcel of our existence. Our existence. So can you imagine that what a great kind of a favor we could do to the animals and all that is around us, Prakriti, that gives us life on earth, existence on earth, meaning on earth. So when we go through a certain sense, then the sense is around us first. Now let us visualize again. What is the first sense a person has? The first sense. Can somebody say?
Sight.
Pardon?
Sight.
All right. What else?
Smell. It's
first sense. Sense.
Feeling. Feeling. Touch.
Sense of touch. Who said it? Sense of touch. Because during conception, then life is born. Then life is born, isn't it? But the sense of touch is around us. It's around. Would you like to have some water? The sense is around us, first in nature. And what is the sense of touch? The seed. When the seed of a tree germinates, it is the sense of touch that comes from the power of life. And that is the sense of touch that germinates the seed. And this is exactly what happens during conception. The human being is the bij. The human being is a bij mantra. And the bij is the seed. And then the seed cracks open in the ground. That's the first sense. Sense of touch. Because it's in the atmosphere, in the pranamaya kosha, which is the etheric. Prana means the life force. Maya means illusionary, and kosha means the sheet. And we have the etheric sheet, prana maya kosha, and it is in the etheric, in the life around us. That is the first sense, sense of touch. When the sun comes into a certain direction, then on earth, where the sun has the power to illuminate Pashyanti and give the sense of touch in the environment, the human being experiences the sense of touch during conception. And then when we further advance after the sense of touch, what can you imagine can be after the sense of touch? What can you imagine? Which sense could there be?
Movement.
Movement, very good, but it comes after this sense. Very good, it's coming. But just after the sense of touch is the sense of balance.
Balance. Secure, I mean that feeling.
Secure, yes.
With a touch, you feel embryo also.
Yes.
With the mother touch.
Yes, yes.
Feel that he is secure.
Exactly, exactly. This is it. And this is how also destiny starts. Because destiny is a sense of balance. It brings a sense of balance into the human being, in nature as well as the human being. But mind you, this is all in the mother's cosmic womb. The cosmic womb which is outside, the cosmos, and the human being. So after the sense of touch, we have the sense of balance, where there is also under the ground, this is still under the ground, huh, mind you, because the seed is now just germinating. Now comes a very small shoot, which is the sense of balance. The shoot must have sense of balance, otherwise it can't grow. Without balance, it just can't grow. And then comes the sense of movement. This is it. And the sense of movement is what happens under the ground where the warmth is taking place. Now comes the horizon. It starts to move. And as soon as things start to move, as soon as the cosmos moves, then comes life. Movement brings life. Why? Because movement has balance. And what is balance? Rhythm. Rhythm of the seasons, rhythm of the day, rhythm of the heartbeat, rhythm of the blood circulation, rhythm of breathing. It's the Shivji's Damru. That is the rhythm. And that is the sense of movement, which contains in itself the rhythm. And this is where the child starts to move in the cosmos. And the doctor with the stethoscope says, that's it. Now comes life. After the movement comes life, the sense of life. Now it's very interesting, you know, that when we advance further, we carry these senses with us. So when we have the sense of touch, and it was very interesting what you said, that it's the mother who touches the child later on and gives security to the child. Later on in life, the human being, the adult, experiences from the sense of touch, sense of godliness. They have this very powerful effect. And it's very interesting that in India, almost everyone believes in Almighty, isn't it? I mean, we have hardly any atheists in our country because our mothers have really carried us, and then later on comes all these push prams and all this. But you know, this mother's touch when the child is carried everywhere and all this, even when the mother is working, the working women who carry the child on them, they have the sense of touch. And then when the child becomes an adult, comes the sense of godliness. These senses can be transformed. And then comes the sense of balance. After touch is the balance. And the sense of balance, when one allows the child to make a free play, then later on the adult experiences the sense of equanimous. No. Inward. Sense of balance. It can be transformed from the embryo into the adulthood as the sense of equanimity, peace, tranquility, equanimity. With the sense of movement, when sense of movement is transformed, what can come? What can you imagine in our adult years? Freedom of thought. It's amazing, this freedom of thought that comes when the sense of movement is transformed.
Freedom of choice.
Yes, exactly. Freedom of choice, but with responsibility. We read so very often in the newspapers now that this article or that article, but people sometimes lose out the freedom of choice, and they can become very, very narrow-minded, and then they write certain things which can be very offensive to people. So freedom of choice is freedom of responsibility. Freedom of choice and freedom of thought must be with freedom of responsibility, not to hurt anybody else's feelings, not to offend. That is the freedom of thought. It's not freedom that I can do anything to anybody or say something or write anything in the newspaper. And I mean, all these things have to be transformed into a proper responsibility, into proper responsibility where the human being has really gone through the biography of life. And then after the sense of movement comes the sense of life. Then in the sense of life, the human being learns the sense of truth. Because you can even say it mind, certainly. But mind has the sense of truth, isn't it?
Yes.
Isn't it? Mind has the sense of truth. And you see, why does the sense of life give the sense of truth? Because when we say that the sense of life gives the human being the possibility to become aware of one's own health. How much can I eat? How much do I don't eat? What can I eat? When to eat? What to eat? All this has to do with the sense of life. And if a person experiences the sense of health, that that person can never go wrong. Eating wrong food, eating more than the person needs, they can never go wrong because a person experiences the sense of health. So this is what sense of life gives, sense for health. Sense for truth is sense for health. Really, truth is health. If we are really aiming for or going into the direction of maintaining good health, not just bodily but also mentally, then we are aiming and going in the direction of the sense for truth, because truth is health. Nothing to do with morality. It has to do with our bodily condition, our mental condition. And now after the sense of life comes this. Now it's very interesting that during the time of the sense of life comes now slowly the plant above the earth. And life you see around. And now comes the great rejoicing of holy. Life, life around, holy, pichkari, all these colors and joy of life, and spring comes now, spring. And during the time of spring, what happens is that every plant, every shoot that comes is individualized, is covered now, slowly is covered. This very, very delicate shoot is covered into a certain layer, into a certain cover. And this cover is the individuality. I and you, you and I, because of this cover. Now this is my space. So you see, when during spring comes now the sense of individuality in the plant world, in the human being comes the sense of responsibility, different than the sense of life, the sense of self-identity. Sense of individuality, dignity, comes the sense of dignity. Now I'm a human being made in the image of God. That is the sense of dignity, which is in nature, covering. When the nature is covered, then comes this kind of sense also in the human being. You see how deeply we are related through the pranamaya kosha, through the etheric, with the nature and the human being. And then, afterwards, after holy spring, now we are advancing slowly from this covering of the all nature is covered now. Now we can say this is a mango tree, this is a banana tree, this is a palm tree, because now every tree has its individuality. Now this is Ashok, this is Maya, this is Sheila, this is Sharmila, and all, you know, everything. Every human being is now, in a way, an individuality. And then, when we go over from the spring equinox, then we enter the sense of thought, thinking, the sense of thought. The sense of identity gives the sense of thinking. And this thinking is a picture image of then in nature. What happens is the sense of thought is very powerful, you know, because thoughts can toxify our body. Health is in the mind, and from the mind one can really bring poison into the body or bring good health into the body. Toxification. If a person is sound in mind and says, oh well, there is so much of light and the thinking which is evolved, or some people who have a certain responsibility of thinking, then they also have a sound body. So even when the body goes through karmic process of illness, yet the person feels strong. I have worked for many, many years with cancer patients, and some of the patients who have been going through the cycle of life and death, and during in this incarnation they have had cancer in their body, the whole body wrecked with cancer and pain, and yet they were free. They said, well, I'm healthy, because the mind was healthy. So this is the thought that gives to the human being the power of thinking and bringing the body into once more in under their kind of not power but under their control in a way. And then when we further advance towards summer, now we have the sun that brings us the responsibility of the sense of speech. After thought comes to speech, the sense of speech. But with the speech, we also have the sense of silence. That's very important. We say, speech is silver, silence is gold. So we have now gold, silence. Knowing when to stop. Knowing when to keep quiet. Knowing when not to speak. So, sense of speech. What is sense of speech in nature? Pollination. Pollination. One flower talking to the other through the pollinating. They're speaking with each other. They're communicating. Pollination is communication in nature. And this communication in nature gives us the sense of speech. Isn't it remarkable that we are able to communicate? And it's very interesting that when we see later on, when we work on this, then what sense stands opposite of which sense? It's very interesting that the sense of speech stands exactly opposite the sense of touch. Because with our words we can touch the person. It's like an arrow, isn't it? Touch the person in a good or a bad way.
Is it not, but it is a complementary?
Yes.
Touch and
exactly, it is, isn't it? Because it's very interesting that you raise this question. Because see, we are about the equator, isn't it? So now, it's like of winter here, it's winter. Also in the rest of Europe, it's winter, almost winter. But when you go down to Australia and New Zealand, there they have summer, you see? So this is how it happens, that the opposite sense complement each other. So when these senses are standing now, otherwise it will be too complicated if I were to go with every opposite sense. But it's just, I just give an example, and you had carried it off very well when you say complementing. So this is it, that the sense of speech complements the sense of touch. And that is down below. In Australia, New Zealand, South America, where they are having, under the equator, they are having summer now, and they are having the opposite season. So this is how the senses are working. They are working different levels. So now where were we? Which sense were we? Sense of?
Wisdom.
Speech,
exactly. Sense of communicating. And now we enter summer. Slowly, summer, warmth. Which sense could it be? Sense of?
Warmth.
Very good. Sense of warmth it is. Now we are entering the sense of warmth. And the sense of warmth actually is a sense that brings us aware of our own space, our inner space, and awareness. If we are aware of our own inner space, we are aware for the space of the other person. And we would never offend that person through our behavior, through our movement especially. We would never put anybody into inconvenience, parking at the wrong side, in a sense of warmth gone astray. Really, really it is true that there the sense of warmth is not really quite unfolding itself. Every aspect bringing other people into inconvenience is the sense of warmth that has gone pathological. I say that. It's really true. Because the sense of warmth is respect for the other person's space. And when we see, sometimes really, I've experienced that with the traffic and also when we step outside, that people have absolutely no regard for the other person's sense of space. Because they don't they lack the sense of space in themselves. Then one brings this kind of inconvenience to the other person in just about every way. In any case, these are all issues that one can teach in schools, you know, and to really, when a child until the age of 7 or 10 is also well, with the warmth of the mother, the love and the, all the consideration of people who are there with the child, that kind of sense of warmth will give later on in the adult life really a sense of inner space. And if a person has a sense of inner space, I tell you, that person would never ever bring anyone into inconvenience, because that is reciprocated. One really experiences that other person's sense of warmth, sense of space. So all these 12 senses are pedagogical. They are educational. How can we bring little children into these kind of just simple little things of everyday life so that in their adult years, they will transform these senses into something that is contributory to our civilization, to the world, not just India, Indians, but the world in general, because we are world citizens. We are born on this world, we are world citizens first, and then we are Indians and this national and this and that religion, but we are human beings. So in this way we can transform these senses with just simple little aspects. So when we go from the sense of warmth, now comes the sense of sight. From the warmth, and that is the harvest time, the harvest time. And this harvest time is a kanya, that is the Rashi kanya, isn't it? The kanya Rashi. And it's very interesting when you see the hieroglyphy of the kanya Rashi. Kanya, she comes with, sometimes in old literature, scripture, she comes with a basket of fruits, flowers. In Greece, they used to have Demeter, goddess Demeter. She represented kanya, the Virgo, the virgin. That's the time of the constellation Virgo, the harvest time, the harvest, where there is a plenty, lot of fruits, flowers, colors now in summer. Now summer is slowly now entering winter time. So there is a lot of harvest. And then when we have the sense of sight, what does it do, the sense of sight? The sense of sight in later years. I mean, how can you cultivate sense of sight in a child? You know, it's very interesting. You keep your word. When the mother says, tomorrow we will go out into the garden, if she keeps her word, just something so simple, then the child experiences in adult life perception to look within and see the truth in a situation. Then nobody will exaggerate or go haywire talking nonsense or lies or things like that. Oh, somebody met me and said something so bad about this. Just from the figment of fantasy and imagination, defaming this person, defaming that person. You know, it all goes into this kind of lies. And these lies can really wreak havoc in our society. So with the sense of sight, what happens during this harvest time? There is so much of to look around, beautiful beauty in nature. So this is how, if you really keep this kind of word, just simple things. And it's very sad. We have a neighbor where we are living, and he always tells, he's the uncle of that little boy. He's about 4 years old. And he always tells the little boy, if you do this, then the bad man will come and get you. I mean, just imagine what it does to that child's sense of sight. I'm sure that such children, they would have glasses very, very early in life, because they are fed such kind of tales, such kind of nonsense that has been spoken around. So you see, these things can really wreak havoc on the senses, and later on, the child who grows into the adult has very little perception. And then after the sense of sight, one enters into the sense of equanimous, which is the sense of taste. Good taste. See, good taste. When the mother cooks at home, even if she has to work, but she sees that the child is fed warm food and not just Lay's, this type of, you know, this junk food or from McDonald's, all this taste. Later on in adult life, the child has very bad taste to crack a bad joke or to say something offensive or to write offensive. See what has happened now in France. They wrote such offensive things and then they were killed. There is nothing to justify, but still, it's the sense of taste gone wrong, because it's bad taste to offend. And so, with this kind of sense of taste, that is the autumn equinox. How can one bring balance now from good taste? And then, after the autumn equinox, slowly one arrives into the winter, now the ground starts to harden. Everything becomes very physical, material. Annamaya kosha, physical body, material body. Everything becomes hardened, cold, and that is in now slowly entering the winter. And that time, there is a sense of smell. Sense of smell is the most physical material of all senses. Why? Because when a person, the corpse is decayed, the person has passed away, the corpse, that goes into the physical material, something that is dead, goes into the complete physical material, because there is no pranamaya kosha. There is no etheric anymore, no life body. So this kind of physical material is the sense of smell. But it's very interesting. I have heard that when a person who is evolved, let us say a yogi, a saint who is evolved, that person has the fragrance of sandalwood. So the sense of smell can be transformed into fragrance of sandalwood. It is the highest. You see, we feed sandalwood when we do the yajna, isn't it? Why do we feed sandalwood? Because it's the highest, it's the most evolved fragrance of the human being. And this is what is represented in a sandalwood. So that's the sense of fragrance. When the sense of smell is transformed into sense of fragrance. For instance, when everything is kept clean in the house, it's proper, doesn't have to be perfume. On the contrary, perfumes are smelly. Through the perfume, one can manipulate unconsciously many things. Perfume industry is very manipulative, I must say. But I'm talking about fragrance. And that kind of fragrance comes from within. And so that is the sense of smell that goes into the hardening physical material where winter now is setting in. And then comes life. After everything is dead and gone, then comes resurrection again. Brahma, once more, the creator. And then comes the sense of touch, once more. So it's kind of a transformation. Also on the zodiac we have the cardinal, the mutable and the fixed, which is the starting, the beginning, the sustenance and arriving. Once more comes the starting, sustenance, arriving. The three gunas, we have the rajas, we have the sattva, rajas and tamas. So this is then what is permeating from the four of elements into the three of the gunas. And this way every object has these three gunas. And that is what we are trying now, slowly, when we have arrived, slowly starts new life. When a person has achieved zero point in life, then comes the resurrection inwardly. Something new, something that is very special. So this is now the end of our... but I would say that it is not the end, but it is more the... beginning of a new, exactly, because I'm sure that we will all go home and think about it. You know, it's very interesting that when I have time and I'm sitting really, and I love to be alone and just think about these things, then very often one really comes to so many questions. And questions are very important. Questions are more important than answers, isn't it? Because every question is a seed. And the answer is the tree.
That is the start of paradigm shift.
Start of paradigm shift. You see, this is it. This is it. It's the start. It's the new beginning. So this is what happens.